really look forward to hearing all that you've got to tell.
Thank you very much.
This slight sadness that it's going to be the last time.
Yeah, in truth, it's because, you know, I think I flogged Grenville half to death, and I think with the sorry affair over the building on the corner here, which is so important to this town, likely to come to its unhappy conclusion at the end of the month, I think it's kind of time to sort of say, well, okay, I have tried. So, you know, that's why, you know, I mean, hey, if the BBC want to do a documentary on Bideford and they want to pay me for doing it, I'll come back. I'll do that thing like all the sort of artists do, you know, they keep having comeback tours, don't they?
Yes,
you know,
they don't, yes.
So I'll try that. But hopefully at least I'll be a little bit better than the Who were at Glastonbury, because I understand they were pretty awful on stage, but there we are. So I'm probably going to cut that bit, because I'm going to be sued for that bit. Is that all right?
I won't tell Pete. He did apologise.
Did he? Oh, right. I'm so glad about that.
He actually played quite well. It was only the sound.
Oh, dear. Okay. Wonderful. Right. There's a quiz tonight. You didn't know that, did you?
No.
Okay. Do you all know what that building is? You all know what that building is? Yes, Andy, this is good. This, of course, is the Grenville Manor House in Bideford, the original manor house, which David Carter and I are absolutely convinced, and it can be no other, that this is where Sir Richard Grenville was born on the 15th of June, 1542. We have numerous records referring to this building or a building on this site, and the earliest of those records actually goes back to 1256. For a building on this site. And some of the foundations of this building have a clear suggestion that they date to that period of time. Now, my second revelation tonight, after thanking Peter Christie, is something that no one has seen before. Somebody has very kindly been working at this for a while. It's not perfect, but this is a first time. So you're all going to see this. It's very hard when you look at that building to imagine what it might have looked like at the time of Sir Richard Grenville, because let's face it, it's been chopped around quite dramatically. It's lost various features over the years. It's been altered quite dramatically. But we know enough about the internal arrangement of that building to be able to take a guess of what it may have looked like some time ago. Okay, we know that in the medieval period, it would have been what they called a hall house. And then obviously they've done additions like every family does. You build a bit on because you've got a bigger family or you've got a bit more land to do. So this is a first. This has been very kindly done free of charge by someone. But this is what we think the manor house once looked like. Okay. Which is really, really quite an extraordinary building. I'll do that for you. Okay. Much better than PowerPoint, isn't it, when they're going to stand there and show everyone. There you go, Mike. All right, you can get a little glimpse of that. And that's what we believe it looks like. We're not quite sure about this window. We think it was probably more over here. But essentially, it's a pretty good reproduction of what we believe the building actually looked like. Now, could you imagine what would happen if we chipped all the old modern stuff off of that building and returned it to make it look like that? Wouldn't that be fantastic? So, that's the manor house. Now, of course, obviously, we say 15th of June, 1542, but in best Latin, I can assure you these following words are written at the foot of Sir Richard Grenville's grandfather's will, okay, which was proved in 1550. Et 15 de Juno ultimo predictus idem Richardus Grenville sunt etato otto annorum et non amplus. I haven't spoken Latin since I left school. Sorry about that. Translates as, on the 15th of June last, meaning 1550, the aforesaid same Richard Grenville was aged 8 years and no more. Which means, of course, unquestionably, that Sir Richard Grenville was born on the 15th of June, 1542. Okay? His father was Roger Grenville, who was captain of the Mary Rose. It's a little bit unfortunate because, of course, it sunk in 1545 in Portsmouth Harbour. And if you've not seen that ship, I urge you to go to Portsmouth to have a look at it. He had two brothers, John and Charles, who both died in infancy. We don't know about the death of John, but we know that Charles died at Buckland Monachorum in 1544. So he had a little bit of an unfortunate childhood, because by the time he's 3 years old, he's lost both his brothers and his father. He has only his mother to call family. So, you know, the guy should be forgiven for having a pretty rough start to life. Nevertheless, he was sent at a very early age to learn sort of law in London at the inner courts. And in 1562, he did what all teenagers do, etc. Well, I say teenager, he was 20 years old by then. He had a bit of an altercation with a guy called Roger Bannister. Not that Roger Bannister. Okay. And according to an eyewitness, and I quote, ran him through with his sword. Meaning he killed Roger Bannister. Obviously, he lived. They didn't hang him for it. And obviously, in 1565, we know that he married Mary St. Leger. Now, the St. Leger family lived at Annery at Weir Gifford. In fact, the stable block is still there. Where they got married, I don't know. There's no record of them marrying here, unfortunately. So we think most likely they may have married at Monkley Parish Church, because that would have been the local parish church. However, the Grenvilles had 8 children that we know of. So would you like to know about their children? Yes, Andy, this is good. You're getting the idea now, aren't you? I can tell. So, excuse me, because age is not kind to any of us, is it? The oldest was probably called Roger, which seems logical. You call him by his father's name. He was born late 1565, but appears to have died in infancy. We think he was buried at Kilcampton. The second child, Mary, was born in 1567 and went on to marry Arthur Tremaine of Colicombe at Kilcampton on the 2nd of June, 1586. They had 21 children. Okay. Yeah. The interesting thing is that the first two, Edmund and Diggory, were both baptised here. So, quite interesting. Mary actually died on the 2nd of June 1608 and is buried at Lamerton Church. Their next child was Bernard, who was actually the heir to the Grenville Empire ultimately. He was born in 1567 as well, same year as Mary. So, were they twins? We think probably they may well have been, which is pretty unusual. He died in 1636. But he seems to have been a little bit like the calm after the storm, because he kind of didn't do an awful lot. He gave away a lot of power to the town, town council. But the one thing he did do, which is very significant, now we're very comfortable about this, we think he was responsible for some major alterations to the Grenville Manor House. A lot of the work that we have been able to date there dates to the period 1610, 1620, when he was in charge of the estates. So it's a very, very key period of history. In 1570, Catherine was born, and she married Justinian Abbott. If that name's familiar, he owned Hartland Abbey at the time, and they had one daughter. Catherine was reputedly buried in 1603, but obviously had a resurrection, because in her mother's will of 1619, she appears to be alive. So, you know, history is not all kind of what it's made out to be. Next Grenville child is one I think would have been a fascinating individual had he lived. He was called John. Now, at 18 years of age, he was put in charge of one of Grenville's ships that went on to fight against the Spanish Armada at 18 years of age. Real chip off the old block, I think. Tragically, he died probably from some kind of fever or sickness in 1595 while captaining a ship on Sir Walter Raleigh's ill-fated voyage to Guyana. In 1573, Bridget was born. Now, Bridget's quite interesting because there's a memorial to her in Bristol Cathedral. She married a gentleman called, let me just check this out here, it says John Weeks. Mr. Weeks, sir? A relative of yours, possibly? Yeah. Absolutely. All right. So you might have Grenville blood in you. All right. Okay. I'll remember that next time I doff my cap in your direction. The monument's fantastic because it's like, oh, woe is me, I'm so sorry to have lost my wife, etc., blah, blah, blah. She was wonderful, blah, blah, blah. But 6 months later, he married his second wife. So, you know, maybe not quite such the wonderful woman. Rebecca, I think, is a little bit sad. She was the next child, but she died aged 12 on the 9th of June, 1589, possibly from influenza. And it seems to have been the same outbreak that killed a couple of other members of the Grenville family at the time, and servants and what have you. including a certain Native American Indian, Rawley, who I'll talk about in a minute. And she was unquestionably buried here. That date, 9th of June, 1589, is here in the parish register. Their final child is one I think is a great mystery, Ursula. She was born in 1581. Now, she was born at a time when her mother was already 40 years of age. When her mother died in 1623, she reported, obviously, we know at that time that Ursula actually remained unmarried. She died in 1643, still unmarried, which is very unusual for that time. However, her mother's will says the following words: "My will and desire is that my daughter Ursula shall, after my decease, remain and be under the government and tuition of my daughters Catherine Abbott and Bridget Grenville, and they to have and receive her yearly rent or annuity of £30 from her brother Bernard for her maintenance." Think about that, government and tuition at a time when Ursula was already 38 years of age. Her mother was 40 years of age when she was born. Is it just possible that Ursula may well be the first documented case of Down syndrome? We may never know, but she's buried in this church somewhere. So I just find that quite a fascinating piece of history. Anyway, obviously Sir Richard Grenville did what all men of the day did. As soon as he gets married and there's a child on the way, he disappears off to fight the Ottoman Empire in Austria. He goes on to try and settle some estates in Ireland. We have well-documented stories of him going over there with cousin Sir Walter to set up estates. And Sir Walter Raleigh, by the way, was mayor of Ewell at one point, which is just along the coast from Cork. And I think it's quite obvious that Sir Richard Grenville saw all these Irish estates and thought, trade, Bideford, I'm sailing backwards and forwards from Bideford to Ewell all the time. I think there's money to be had here because we could be the main port for servicing the estates in Southern Ireland. So I'm going to get a charter for the town. I'm going to set up a town council. And I'm also going to get a charter for the port at the same time so that we can actually have customs and revenue generated by the port. So that's a little bit visionary on his part, although quite if you could see all what it became over the next sort of two centuries, obviously is questionable. But I'm quite clear that he must have seen some potential in developing the port with the Irish colonies, etc. at the time. One of my most sort of grievous moments of Sir Richard Grenville's life story is 1575. He spent 2 years planning a voyage. And it's well documented, this voyage, because he bought a ship called the Castle of Comfort. He armed it to the teeth. And in his little précis that he wrote off to Queen Elizabeth, he said, "I want to take this ship, armed to the teeth, and I want to sail to South America. I want to steal all the Spanish gold, and then I'm going to go round the pointy bit at the bottom and up the coast, and I'm going to steal more of the Spanish gold. And then when I get to San Francisco Bay, apart from the fact I'll go and see Hollywood and things like that, I'm then going to cross the South Sea." South Sea being the Pacific Ocean, of course. Because that must be a shortcut to the Spice Islands. And then obviously I'm going to pick up all these spices and discover that and then sail back to England. So I'll be back in 3 or 4 months. Fantastic. Well plotted out, well documented. It's in the National Archives, this document. He was declined. He was declined because apparently the ship, the Castle of Comfort, was never known in fair trade, meaning it was always up to piratical things at the time. Whether in Grenville's charge or not is unclear. I can tell you on the back of the document, the words that are written on the back of that document are "Mr. Grenville's South Sea Voyage." And it's signed by Lord Burghley. Does anyone know of anyone else who kind of took a single ship and sailed round South America and duffed up the Spanish and then crossed? You're getting a clue here, aren't you? Sir Francis Drake. You will get to understand I don't like Sir Francis Drake. Okay. I think, you know, Sir Francis Drake was also his cousin. It must be pretty obvious that he would have known what Grenville was up to, because Grenville planned this voyage certainly for at least 3 years that we know of. So, you know, you kind of talk to your friends, don't you, and your family, and you say, I have a cunning plan. Yeah? And I think, if I'm honest with you, I'm absolutely certain that Drake simply took the idea for himself and ran with it, and obviously the rest, as they say, is history. It's quite clear that there was no love loss between Sir Richard and Sir Francis Drake, even before we get to the really important bit about why I hate Francis Drake. Because in we do know that from about 1540 right through to about 1580, the Grenvilles owned Buckland Abbey. Now, if I mention Buckland Abbey, you're going to think, well, that's Francis Drake's home. It is, or it was. But if you go there and move all the signs away from the fireplaces that are all kind of just on the corners of the mantelpiece, you will see behind all those little modern signs the coat of arms of the Grenvilles on every fireplace in that building. It was his grandfather that bought it. We even know how much he paid for it. And they set about redeveloping it. And Grenville did a substantial amount, spent a substantial amount of money there. Sir Richard Grenville spent a substantial amount of money redeveloping it. It's actually the place he called his Castle of Comfort, okay? Hence where the name of the ship came from. In 1580, he sold it to a gentleman called Christopher Harris, who was an acquaintance of his, of Radford near Plymouth, for the princely sum of £3,400, who a few weeks later sold it to Sir Francis Drake. I'm pretty sure that Christopher Harris was simply an intermediary for the transaction. I think that's fairly comfortable that that's what was going on. So Sir Richard Grenville would have kind of pottered around the West Country and lived his life quietly thereafter. You know, he was doing his thing in Ireland, which the Queen commanded him to do, etc. And that would have been it. Except his cousin, Sir Walter Raleigh, said, I've just got a charter here from Queenie, and it says, I can make what money I can out of the entire United States of America for 7 years. That's not a bad deal, is it, really? So Sir Walter Raleigh actually sent two ships over in 1584. They left from Plymouth. The two ships were captained by Arthur Barlow and Philip Amardus. Philip Amardus, we know, came from Launceston, or Lanston, or however it's pronounced. And they find the Outer Banks of North Carolina, and they meet with the Native American Indians. Now, imagine that first contact. They actually talk about being moored by an island, and then they saw one of the local savages, as they called them, in his canoe, beach his canoe, you know, just near where the ships were, and then walk up and down the beach, eyeing up these two English ships. And they beckoned him over, and he rowed his canoe across to the ship and met with Captain Amardus and Barlow. Complete first contact. They go on to describe meeting the king and various other people, etc. And they say, this is fantastic. There's so much food and places you can grow grain and crops and wildlife, etc. and what have you. Perfect place for a colony. So they come back to England and tell Sir Walter Raleigh, got the great place for you to set up your sort of bridgehead in America. Now, ladies and gentlemen, I have to tell you, if you've never been to the Outer Banks, it's actually a sandbar. That's about the best way I can describe the whole of the Outer Banks. It's a sandbar. It's just sand as far as the eye can see. There's really not a lot there, but they reported it was a land of milk and honey. And that's very important that you remember that. But he comes back, they come back, report this to Sir Walter Raleigh, and Sir Walter Raleigh thinks, I need to go and set up now a military bridgehead. I need to establish a military bridgehead before I take over the colonists. I'm going to have a word with my cousin, Sir Richard Grenville, and ask him if he wouldn't mind doing me a favour. So Sir Richard Grenville actually writes an indenture, which is kind of like a last will and testament, that if he doesn't come back on this journey, he would like this to happen to his estate and this to be done and his people to be looked after and so on and so on and so on. That document actually exists in the National Archives and tells us exactly what he wanted done with his estate if he did not come back from Roanoke. So we know that Sir Richard Grenville took the Tiger and the Roebuck from Bideford with some military men on board, sailed to Plymouth to meet a gentleman called Ralph Lane, with some more military people, and in seven ships they set sail for Roanoke Island to set up the military bridgehead. Now we know a great deal about that voyage. Why? Because there is a ship's log recorded from that voyage. It's unlikely that it was in Richard Grenville's hand. It appears to have been in possibly one of the masters on board. We're not absolutely sure. But it makes for quite interesting reading. One of the things I particularly like is where they arrive on Puerto Rico. They set up a fort to do some repairs and maintenance and refuel and get some laying supplies. And they spot a load of Spanish horsemen looking at them from the ridge above. And they say that the Spanish horsemen came down and parleyed with them under a flag of truce and said, you're on our land, like, go away, you know, you're not allowed here. And so Richard Grenville actually records, well, for all their posturing and their arrogance and what have you, they told us to leave immediately. And we said, well, you know, sort of rule of the sea here, allow us to refuel and we'll be on our merry way. In the Spanish archives at the collection Navarrete is the Spanish commander's version of the very same meeting, ladies and gentlemen. And he says, we met with the English under a flag of truce, and all their posturing and swaggering and their arrogance and all the rest of it, they told us they had 22 Spanish prisoners, which they were going to sell for slavery. He said, sell as slaves. That's interesting. Which one do you believe? Questionable. But anyway, they have some more adventures there. And I have just a couple of little fragments I'd like to just read to you from the original document. The 24th day of May, we set sail from St. John's. The same night, we took a Spanish frigate, which was forsaken by the Spaniards upon the sight of us. And the next day in the morning, very early, we took another frigate with good and rich freight and diverse Spaniards of accompaniment in her, which afterwards we ransomed for good round sums. Meaning he took the Spaniards and flogged them, basically, for money. 5th of June, our English general, I'm talking about Sir Richard Grenville here, and the Spanish governor discoursed between them of diverse matters as to the state of the country, the multitude of the towns and people, and the commodities of the island. The island is Hispaniola. They're talking between Richard Grenville and the governor of the island of Hispaniola. Our men provided two banqueting houses covered with green boughs, the one for the gentlemen, the other for the servants, and a sumptuous banquet was brought in, served by us all in plate, meaning on pewter, which was kind of the best silverware of the day, with the sound of trumpets and consort of music, wherewith the Spaniards were more than delighted. Now, interestingly, the Spaniards reciprocated by actually letting some bulls run free, and the English and the Spanish rode side by side and hunted down the bulls and killed them. And that also is documented. Now, what's interesting also about this little record is that the Spanish governor, he makes an interesting comment. When Amadis and Barlow came back to England in 1584, they brought back with them two Native Americans who were called Manteo, or Manio as it's pronounced today, and Juan Chis. They were presented to Queen Elizabeth. This Spanish governor, in his account, says they had with them two Native American Indians, or savages, who wore fine clothes, had a love of good music, and could speak good English. Manio and Juan Chis heading back to America with Sir Richard Grenville. I quite like this little comment here as well. The 11th day of July, the general accompanied in his tilt boat with Master John Arundel. Well, that's not a local name, is it? The Arundels at Trurice. Master Stookley, well, we don't know who they are, do we? We've never heard of the Stookleys before, of course, from Heartland. And divers other gentlemen, Master Lane, Master Cavendish, Master Harriet, and 20 others in the new pinnace. Captain Amadis, Captain Clark, spelt with an E, by the way, as well. So I wonder if Steve Clark had relatives here. With 10 others in a ship boat, Francis Brooke and John White. who became painter and governor. You'll know about him in a minute. In another ship boat, passed over the water from Ocracoke to the mainland, victualled for 8 days, in which voyages we discovered the towns of Pomeok, Aquascogoc and Secotan. Now, John White was a painter in the first instance, and we know all about his paintings because most of them still exist and they are at the British Museum. They're not on show, but this is one of his paintings of the Outer Banks of North Carolina. And I can tell you now that this is actually pretty accurate today. If you had this map with you today and you'd never been there before, you'd be able to work out where you are. So it's an astonishingly accurate map, which obviously was painted in 1585. There's Roanoke Island, where the town of Manteo sits today, and that was their destination. Keep your eye on this little ship down the bottom here. This is very important. See this little ship on the bottom here? Keep your eye on that ship, because you're going to learn something about that little ship in a minute. But obviously, say John White was painting, he painted various things, and I mentioned that they actually visited the town of Secotan, okay, which is a Native American Indian settlement. Well, there's the village of Secotan that John White painted. You can all have a look at these afterwards if you wish. Actually says down the bottom there, Secotan. It's the same village. So this is his work. And these are, as I say, in the British Museum. So, another little entry from 1585 voyage reads, about the 31st of August, he took a Spanish ship, talking about Grenville, of course, of 300 tons richly laden, boarding her with a boat made from boards of chests which fell asunder and sunk at the ship's side as soon as ever he and his men were out of it. It's getting a bit like Pirates of the Caribbean, this bit, isn't it? You enjoying that? Okay. Well, I've often gone on about the Santa Maria de Vincenzi, which is the ship that Grenville took at Bermuda. It's 300 tons, twice the size of his own ship, the Tiger. And I thought, well, why would you have a single Spanish ship on its own, a treasure ship at that, that Grenville took, etc. It's incredibly well documented, and I'm about to tell you why in a minute. But what I can tell you is that Grenville brought that ship back to Bideford and converted it to become the galleon Dudley, which then went on to fight against the Spanish Armada 3 years later. I am absolutely convinced that the cannons in the park today, or at least eight of them, I know for a fact, ladies and gentlemen, are not Spanish Armada cannons as labelled. They are much earlier, possibly 20 years earlier in origin than Spanish Armada cannons. The report that's referred to on that sign, Captain Enthoven's report, claims that they came from Hope Cove in South Devon. So why were three of them found mounted as mooring posts on the quayside by the bridge and the other five lined up just along the front of the old quayside, the original quayside, at the foot of the quay? Right, okay, that doesn't quite work. Well, I've actually seen the Spanish Armada cannon at Hope Cove because they put them on top of the, they mounted them on top of the cliff there. They're nothing like those cannons there. In fact, in 1929, a gentleman looked at those cannons and said, I don't know where he got his measurements from, this Captain Enthoven, but they're not right. I've measured them myself, and I can tell you they're not Spanish Armada cannons. They are definitely earlier. And he gives a chart in feet and inches and eighths of an inch, and it's very meticulous. And I've measured his chart against those cannons, and he's right. And by the way, 1929, he says, the town really ought to make something of these cannons because they're absolutely priceless. So we have. We've made them as a children's fort where you can put empty beer cans in the end of the muzzles. You know. And by the way, the muzzles are slightly broken because Spanish cannons, when they were seen this, they're much earlier than the Spanish Armada period. These are probably the finest collection we know of demi-calibers. And we are fairly comfortable if you believe that they came from the Santa Maria de Vincenzi because there's really no other coordinating factor. The nearest Spanish Armada ship that they could have come from sunk off the west coast of Ireland, which would mean these eight cannons had to negotiate round the Irish Sea, and instead of going up the main Irish Sea, would have had to have kind of turned right with the tide and sailed into the Bristol Channel, all together, by the way, all at the same time, and get to Lundy, and then turn right at Lundy, and not actually beach themselves against Lundy, and then wait for the tide so that they can get over the Bar of Bideford, all together, by the way, still, and then sort of come down the Torridge, get to the bridge, and then just all nestle themselves lined up against the quayside. Yeah, sure, wonderful, yeah. No. I now know why they were lined up against the quayside, because it was scour protection. The bridge gets scoured away, and they did some scour protection a little while back to protect it from the racing tide, because it just underscores the edge of the quay. And we know from the remains now of the Elizabethan shipyard at Chatham Docks that they used exactly the same principle of lining up old cannons at the foot of the quayside to protect it. And that's what was going on here. And I am firmly of the opinion that those cannons came from Santa Maria de Vincenzi. However, there is nothing better than me shutting up for once and reading you this. I found this very recently, by the way, so it's in the new version of the book. A guy called Enrique Lopez must have been one of the unluckiest men on the planet in 1585, because he's on Cuba, he's on at Havana, and he lives in Lisbon, and he's thumbing a lift home on a Spanish ship. These are his words. Well, they're at least the narrator's words, because he's actually speaking to a gentleman who's recording what he's saying, and this goes in a letter to the Spanish king. Statement made by Enrique Lopez, resident in the city of Lisbon, who arrived in the island of Faial, which is, I believe, in the Azores, on November the 18th, 1585, in search of a vessel, sorry, not fire, not the Azores, my mistake. But anyway, in search of a vessel to which he to continue on his journey with certain companions who were robbed and set ashore on the island of Flores. Yeah, so he's at the Azores. I'm reading myself backwards here. He says that he and other merchants embarked as passengers at Havana aboard the Santa Maria de San Vincenzi. The master was Alonso Corniel, native of Seville. This vessel left from the harbour in the city of San Domingo with 17 others, its convoy laden with hides and sugars and other merchandise. That's how the Spanish describe gold and silver, other merchandise. Useful, isn't it? And they were bound for Seville. They had sailed 2 days and one night when the sea rose and the wind blew against them in such fashion that they had to strike sail, and so remained all night, supposing that the rest of the fleet would do the same. When day broke, however, they could discover that they were all alone. He says, since they were alone, they didn't know quite what to do. They thought they would carry on with their course until they were near Bermuda. When they reached this position on September the 4th, about 10 o'clock in the morning, they discovered a sail following in their wake, which they thought was someone of the rest of their fleet, which had lagged behind. And so, assuming this, they took in their sails and waited for it so that they could continue together. And as they lay in this fashion, the vessel came up, and as she did so, they fired a round of artillery to salute her in token of amity. Whereupon the ship opened fire on them and bore down on them, firing her guns with the intention of disabling them and so cutting up their rigging that they were disabled. Then, recognizing that this was a corsair, pirate, ladies and gentlemen, pirate, which intended to rob them, they made sail, hoping to get away. One man on board was killed, four or five were injured, and two shots struck near the waterline and disabled the ship, so we were almost sinking and we had to stop. The corsair then lowered his boat with 30 armed soldiers and a captain who they called their general, Sir Richard Grenville, he was said to have left England with 14 ships to the Caribbean. They say that as the English general and his men boarded, he ordered the master and the rest on board to hand over all the gold and silver. This is better than Pirates of the Caribbean, this, isn't it? You know. And other things they had in the vessel, promising that he would do them no bodily hurt. The passengers gave up the keys to their boxes, and he unlocked some of them and broke open others and removed lots of gold and silver and pearls that were in them. He took possession of the ship's register and, according to it, demanded the gold and silver and pearls entered on it. And all was delivered to him. The total was over 40,000 ducats. He says that after he, Grenville, had taken possession of the ship, the Englishman ordered 20 of its seamen to be taken to his vessel, the Tiger, which was done. This left only 22 persons on board with seamen, etc., the seamen of his ship on board the Santa Maria de Vincenzi. He says that after he had captured this ship with the aforesaid consignments of gold and silver and pearls and 200 boxes of sugar, and 40 arobas, which weighed about 25 pounds each, or etc. of various sort of spices, 7,000 hides, and 1,000 hundredweight, 50 tons, of ginger and other merchandise, to a value of 120,000 ducats. The Englishman kept his prize with him, meaning that he kept the ship sailing with him. 120,000 ducats, by the way, according to the National Archives, is worth about £9 million today. And then, obviously, he talks on about the fact that they then got to the island of Flores in the Azores, and Grenville sort of went up to the people on the island and wanted some supplies. So he says, recognising that he was a corsair, the people of the island did not wish to furnish him supplies. One of the principal passengers in the ship, who had been robbed, was then landed and begged the people of the island to sell them the supplies they wanted, for if they refused, the English would throw him and his companions overboard to drown, and they would be so made to suffer for it. They believed that the general had determined to do this, and therefore to avoid it, the people of the island gave him what he wanted. He says, as soon as he received his supplies, he set ashore 22 of the Spaniards. However, he kept the remaining 20 and took them with him to England. Now, this is fascinating, this little description. He says that the English corsair's ship was built like a galleass, which is a Spanish design, was a swift sailer and carried a good armament and equipment, two tiers of ordnance, meaning two rows of cannons, on each side, and many fireworks. Remember this map? And I said, watch the little ship on the bottom. That, ladies and gentlemen, is a Spanish galleass. Therefore, I think it beyond reasonable doubt that that ship is Sir Richard Grenville's Tiger. Okay, painted by John White in 1585. In talking with some of the private persons who accompanied the said Richard Grenville, they were told that in the Indies, the English had been to Puerto Rico on the north side of the island, where they took two frigates carrying merchandise, and from there, with five other ships, went to Florida to land 300 men with orders to fortify a settlement. Well, there weren't 300, it was 104 actually, but you know. That Sir Richard Grenville seemed to be a man of quality, for he was served elaborately on silver and gold plate by servants. Many musical instruments were played when he dined, and his appearance was that of an important person. These are the Spaniard's words, not mine. So anyway, 1585, we have the military colony that Grenville leaves behind. They spend about a year on the island. They do a lot of exploration work. They build a fort called Fort Raleigh. Grenville comes back to Bideford with his prize and all the rest of it. And he knows straight away that he needs more supplies for the military colony because the island is just made up of sand and they're not going to survive. So he makes ready ships at Bideford, okay, the Tiger, the Roebuck and a couple others, to sail back with those supplies. We know that on the 26th of April that year, Grenville got stuck on the bar of Bideford going out back to Roanoke. Why do we know that? Because Philip Wyatt's diary of Barnstable records it for us. Grenville gets back to Roanoke and the military colony is gone. There's no sign of it. He actually records, well, they were supposed to be here, what's happened. So he speaks to the Native American Indians and they say, well, this guy came along, he had lots of ships and he'd been ransacking San Augustine and various other sort of Spanish things, and he came by and offered them a lift home and they accepted it. How long ago was this? 2 weeks. Imagine sailing 4,000 miles and finding the colony you left behind had been kind of just taken away home, offered a lift home by someone who wasn't supposed to be there. Any idea who that somebody was? Drake. So Francis Drake, yes. What a plonker. Absolutely true. It was Sir Francis Drake. It's documented. I would love to have been a fly on the wall when Grenville gets back after doing his 8,000 mile round trip and has a word with Francis Drake and Ralph Lane and in front of Sir Walter Raleigh about what the hell is going on here, guys, you know? That must have been a moment to savour. That really must have been. But anyway, the important thing about 1586 with Grenville is he decides to leave 15 of his own men there. And he leaves him with supplies for a year and says, you can hold all of America for me for a year while I go and get some more supplies. But he also has a little spat with some Native American Indians, because not all of them were friendly. And he captures one and brings it back to Bideford. This is Raleigh, the Native American Indian that's referred to in the parish records here, who was baptized in 2 years later in 1588, and unfortunately died the following year. It's also recorded in the parish register. He was an Algonquin Indian from the island of Roanoke, where the town of Manteo, our twin town, sits today, and was brought back here by Sir Richard Grenville. What I particularly like, we have one reference to that 1586 voyage, by the way, and it's from Pedro Diaz. Now, Pedro Diaz is an interesting guy, because if they ever make the film, this is a job for Johnny Depp, because this guy is the pilot of the Santa Maria de Vincenzi. He gets captured by Grenville, brought back to Bideford, and with 20 Spanish men set to work on a project of his on the quayside. You know what they're building? Grenville's manor house that he built with all the money he made from the Santa Maria de Vincenzi. This is the only image we have of it, because there's nothing left, because Bideford did what Bideford does best and demolished the last bit of it in 1937. Pedro Diaz, by the way, eventually escapes, but I'm going to tell you a little bit about that in a minute. What he says is that the captain remained there and left men with ordnance and supplies. In command of them, he left a master coffin. Well, that's not a local connection at all, is it? The coffin family, they're nothing to do with us, no. He also says another one of them was called Chapman, so I don't know who he was, but there we are. He also says that Grenville, when he sailed to the Azores, when he reached the Azores with his men very sick on the way back, he then actually crossed to Newfoundland and then back to the Azores and then back home, all aboard the Tiger, the very ship that he had used the previous year and which he had captured the Santa Maria de Vincenzi with. So by now, this ship's probably done 20, 25,000 leagues at sea. So the Tiger must have been an incredible ship, must have been an absolutely astonishing ship. Pedro Diaz concludes this part of his statement by saying that he remained incapacitated in the house of the English commander. That means Pedro Diaz, whose words these are, was held prisoner by Richard Grenville in Bideford. Was he in the new house? Well, no, because they were still building that at the time. Therefore, where else would he have been in Bideford? Is it just possible that he was held captive in this building? We don't know. It's a fascinating concept. So 1587 comes along. Grenville meets with Sir Walter Raleigh, says we need to send people over to settle the colony. And they agree on about 120 people. The numbers actually vary slightly. We know all their names. There were lots of Berries and Dares and probably 20 other surnames associated with this neck of the woods. The ships actually set sail from Portsmouth, but collected more people and supplies at Plymouth. So we know for a fact that a lot of people from the West Country went, and we're quite certain a lot of them are Bidefordian. And the reason being is because the latest information, we've got a lot of interesting fragments at the moment. The Berry family is a very significant family we're following up on at the moment. We've done a DNA test and we're doing some research on the family history, because there were two Berries on amongst the lost colonists. And we have a document which is dated just before the sailing of that lost colony, which refers to the two names listed in the lost colony. And it's because their fathers died. And so it's what we call an inquisition post-mortem. And it was conducted by Sir Richard Grenville. So we have a connecting document with two lost colony names and Sir Richard Grenville. So there's very clear links there. And you've already heard me talk about Stukeley and Coffin, all local names. Now, Grenville doesn't take him across. He leaves that command to Simon Fernandez, because his pilot, because he's been commanded by Queen Elizabeth to check out the defences in the West Country, because we're about to have a bit of a scrap with the Spanish Armada. Okay? We all know what happened in 1588. But Bideford sent five ships to fight the Spanish Armada, the third largest fleet. Well, it only sent them, ladies and gentlemen, because those ships were lined up here at the quayside at Bideford, ready to go back and resupply Roanoke Colony. We even know from the records of the day that there are a further 11 male colonists and 4 female colonists on board those ships here at Bideford. We know for a fact that John White, the governor of Virginia, the one whose paintings these are, who was charged by Sir Walter Raleigh to lead that colony, must have been resident here in Bideford for several months over the winter of 1587, early 1588, because he actually sailed with the second sailing in 1588 back to Roanoke. We do know the names of those ships, by the way. The Dudley, which you know about, which was the Santa Maria de Vincenzi, had a contingent of about 100 men. So imagine this, this is Bideford Quayside in early 1588. So you have this 300-ton ship, slightly bigger than the Catalina May for size, if you want, with 100 men on board. The Virgin God Save Her, weighing around 200 tons, also owned by Grenville. Its captain was Sir Richard's second son, John, had 80 men to fight the Spanish. The Tiger, weighing between 140 and 200 tons, apparently now, and owned by Grenville. She was captained by James Bostock and carried 100 men. The Golden Hind. No, not that one. Okay. Described as a pinnace of 50 tons, and that was captained by Thomas Fleming. Interesting role that ship had because it was the lookout for the Spanish Armada, and it was the first English ship to spot the Spanish Armada sailing up the English Channel. And there's a wonderful story that something's not quite right, because in the records it appears with two different names. The story we have is that Francis Drake took umbrage over the use of the name Golden Hind, because that was the name of his round-the-world ship, which, of course, at that time was still around. And they apparently objected to it, because the ship was suitably renamed at Plymouth as the Bark Fleming, after its captain. So that's interesting, isn't it? Was Drake being a bit pompous there, I think, probably? But I don't like Francis Drake, as you probably figured. And the Bark St. Leger, which was owned by the St. Legers at Weir Gifford. They had two other ships, the Brave and the Roe, but they never sailed to Plymouth because they sailed with John White back to Roanoke Island. So we have this fantastic story of that. Now, interestingly, the 1588 second voyage didn't quite make it back to Roanoke. They got set upon by the French. I think on Facebook I promised you a bit of blood and gore, didn't I? Do you think it's time for a bit of blood and gore? It's 8:15. Is that sort of, are we after the watershed here now? Okay, can I do this? Okay. This is the account from Pedro Diaz, and he says, with one of their great shot, their master's gunner's shoulder was stroke away, and our master gunner, with a small bullet, was shot into the head. Being by this time grappled and aboard each other, and the fight continued without ceasing for 1.5 hours, in which fight were hurt and slain on both sides 23 of the chiefest men, having most of them, some of them, 6 or 8 wounds, and some 10 or 12 wounds. Being thus hurt and spoiled, they robbed us of our victuals, powder, weapons, and provisions, saving a small quantity of biscuit to serve us scarce for England. Our master and his mate were deadly wounded, so they were not able to come forth from their beds. John White, who was also on board one of those ships, writes, I myself was wounded twice in the head, once with a sword and another time with a pike, and hurt also in the side of the buttock with a shot. 3 of our passengers were hurt also, whereof one had 10 to 12 wounds. Our master was hurt in the face with a pike thrust quite through the head. So I promise you a bit of blood and gore. There you are, first-hand account of a battle. So anyway, they didn't make it back, and Pedro Diaz escaped. The French said, OK, well, you can come with us. And he escaped, but then he escaped from the French at the Isle de Mayo. The Isle de Mayo is Mallorca. So there you go, they were on holiday in Mallorca even in those days. And he escaped from there and made it back to the West Indies. I'll tell you, if they ever make a film of this, Johnny Depp is Pedro Diaz. I'm absolutely certain of it. So 1590, of course, John White finally gets back to the colony. He can't go with Grenville, because Grenville by that time is sailing for the Azores for the Battle of the Flores. John White arrives in Croatoan, or the islands Roanoke and Croatoan in 1590, and finds that the place is deserted. The colonists he left there 3 years earlier have vanished without trace. There are no graves. There is nothing burnt. All the houses are there, empty. Okay. And they've built a great big fort. He actually records the building of this huge fort that he spots there. And they leave a sign, says Croatoan. Well, John White says, well, I know where that is. I told them to leave me a sign, tell me where they'd gone. And the island of Croatoan is today called Hatteras Island. But he never makes it there because he's blown off course by a hurricane. And that's the last anyone knows of the lost colony. Now, I'm going to carry on with the lost colony bit, and then I'm going to come back to Grenville's last stand. William Strachey recorded in 1612 that he had been told that there were some Native American Indians who lived in houses built with stone walls. Interesting. One story above another. These Native American Indians, by the way. So taught them by the English. And at Ritenau, the chief had preserved seven of the English alive. Four men, two boys, and one young maid. Everyone likes to think the young maid was Virginia Dare, the firstborn American. Her mother, by the way, Eleanor Dare, became Charles King in Charles Kingsley's Westward Ho, was renamed Rose Sauterne. I don't know about you, but I think the pub named down the road here would have been much better if it was Eleanor Dare than Rose Sauterne, because everyone just calls it Weatherspoons anyway, don't they? So, you know. But anyway, in 1701, it gets even better. A guy called John Lawson, who's an English surveyor, he says, he meets some of these people, and he says, they tell us that several of their ancestors were white people. This is in 1701, okay? And could talk from a book, as we do. And they had grey eyes as well. And they also lived in stone houses. Now, don't you think it's just a bit odd that you've got Native American Indians with grey eyes that live in stone houses, that talk about their ancestors reading from a book? And yet nobody but nobody investigated those stories. In 1710 is the last reference we have that might refer to the lost colony. And I quite like this one, actually, and one or two of you might enjoy this too. The Reverend John Ermstone of the city of Bath, this is not Bath in England, this is Bath in North Carolina, okay, wrote a letter to his superior about the people from Hatteras Island who came to get baptized. He says, these persons, half Indian and half English, are an offence to my own, and I gravely doubt the kingdom of heaven was designed to accommodate such. They stunk. And their condition was not improved by the amounts of sacramental wine they consumed, nor by the sprinkling of baptismal waters. Wonderful, wonderful reference. I'm going to come back to the lost colony in a minute. 1591, let's talk very briefly about the demise of Sir Richard Grenville, shall we? Because, you know, he's portrayed as a bit of a lunatic who apparently gets shot by his own men. And, you know, and that's kind of all we seem to know about it. I can promise you, ladies and gentlemen, it's complete nonsense. In fact, I'm going to use the word tosh. There we are. Probably sworn on YouTube now. We actually have quite a bit of information from the Spanish archives, which I tend to prefer because they're clearly much more accurate, even if they're slightly dumbed down. It says here, the battle began with the San Felipe, was able to get 9 or 10 men on board the Revenge. In the following hand-to-hand combat, seven of them were killed. The ships broke free. The crew of the Vice Admiral Arambu's flagship then made their attempt to board the Revenge, but were also repelled. His ship, according to Arambu's own admission, was badly damaged in the engagement. It was then the turn of the crew of the Assumption under Don Antonio Manrique to try and board the Revenge, but they too were beaten off. The Spanish account goes on to tell us that by then, the Revenge had become unrigged and dismasted, but was still fighting 24 hours after the battle commenced. She continued to fight, and in a continuing battle, sent Vice Admiral Luis Cotino's ship, the La Serena, and Manrique's Assumption to the bottom of the sea. Yes! They also record that several other ships in the Spanish fleet were badly damaged. I think that's a political statement, don't you? How are you going to explain it to the King of Spain that one ship has kind of sunk several of yours? It's not good. They say that Sir Richard remained on the upper decks until he was shot into the body shortly before midnight on the second day, and while being dressed for his wounds where he fell, received a further shot to the head from the same Spanish marksman. They say he was taken on board the Spanish ship, the actual Admiral's ship. And the Spanish record says this, and I quote verbatim, "Don Alonso would not see him, yet all the rest of the captains and gentlemen did visit him to comfort him and to wonder at his courage and stout heart, for that he showed not any signs of faintness nor changing of colour. He died somewhere en route to Terceira on the 1st of September, and the Revenge sank shortly afterwards." Now, I have to say, actually, that Grenville was not actually deciding to take on the Spanish single-handedly. He was in the bay on the north side of the Flores with sick men from the English fleet, actually commanded to go there and get fresh water and some respite for